open up your Bibles to the book of 1 John. We are in chapter 5 of 1 John. Last week we focused on one verse, and that was verse 13 of chapter 5. Basically what it means and what it doesn't mean. We are saved because of what God has done for us, for what Jesus has done for us. We aren't saved because we're good enough. We're not saved because there is anything in us that can keep us saved. No, we're saved because God has saved us. John tells us that we are overcomers. And verse 5, he says, "Who is he that overcometh the world? But he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God." That's what it takes. We are overcomers of the world because Jesus overcame. He is the victor. He is victorious. And what do? We believe. That's it. We believe. Well, because we believe, there is going to be a response. If we truly believe what Jesus has done for us, we're going to respond in love and gratitude and amazement of the Creator of the universe who'd be willing to take on human flesh and blood and to live the life that we were incapable and incompetent of living, and then be punished with the most gruesome, torturous death that humanity had ever come up with, to be punished for every bad thing we'd ever do. "For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith." That's a victory. Our faith. Our faith is a victory. Faith in what? Jesus Christ, the Son of God. God the Son. I had already gone to work yesterday, and Kathy was leaving, and just before she left, she was accosted by a couple of Gnostics that came to the door, and they wanted to talk to her. And she basically, in just a few words, told them that they didn't have any basis for conversation because she believed that Jesus Christ is God the Son. That was the end of the conversation. They wanted to make her angry. If I was here, I would have gotten angry. Either you believe that Jesus is God the Son, or you don't believe, or you're dead in your sins, or you're going to stand before God and have to answer for every thought, word, and deed and be punished for it in the lake of fire, just like the devil, who saw everything that was true about God and rebelled against him. It's unfortunate. They believe the lie. They don't have the Spirit of truth. They don't have the Holy Spirit. They believe the lie. You can't convince them. Everything's got to change in their life. The devil's hand's got to be taken off of their eyes so that they can see. But the world has blinded their eyes. Their salvation is what they do. That's why they're going door to door. Because that's part of what they need to do in order to make sure that they're going to go to heaven. But till the very day they die, they don't know for sure if they're going to be good enough. So they have to keep on doing what they have to do. It's unfortunate. They have a miserable life now, and they refuse to believe what the Bible says about Jesus Christ. And they're going to have an even worse eternity. Doesn't have to be that way. Because God has already said what the truth is. In verse 10 of chapter 5, he says, "He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave his Son." They're going to have to stand before God and answer, because they're calling God a liar. They'd rather believe their teachers than believe what the Bible says. If you ask them about you know, well, who is it that translated the New World Translation? Ask them, who was it that brought the Greek text together that they translated to come up with this? They'll say, oh, it's all humility. We're not going to have any names here. Why? Because they don't have any scholars. The Greek that we have has been brought together for the most part by unbelievers. And it was translated. Now, a lot of folks are Christians who put this Bible together that we have in our hands. But a lot of the scholarship of the Greek is not by people who have a real relationship with Jesus Christ. Which proves us what? Proves what to us? That's how valid it is. Even an unbeliever can have the Word of God and it can translate to us. We haven't changed it. We aren't manipulating it. We aren't taking out the stuff we don't like and putting in the stuff we do like. No, it is here. Well, these unbelieving scholars who see the Greek text, they're still amazed because there is no other world religion that has extant in its hands sacred texts that are anywhere near as close as what we have in the Bible. The closest other sacred text is a translation 750 years separated from the one who supposedly wrote it. And we've got fragments that are within a generation of it being written that have been unearthed in different places. Well, there's all kinds of witnesses to who God is. But he says, you know, the witnesses of men are one thing, but God himself has given us a witness. That's far more important than the witness of men. We're going to have to stand before God and answer for every word of God that we've ever heard. And when we stand before God and we know that Jesus is our Lord and Savior, every single word that we've heard has changed us. And he says, we have witness in our heart that we are the children of God. A child has the confidence to go and talk to their dad. Even if their dad's in a bad mood, they still got the confidence to go and talk to their dad. How much more of a confidence do we have to come and to our Heavenly Father? And that's what John is talking about. We're God's children. He made us that. It's not just our identity. We have had a change of character as we've been going through this epistle, is what John has said. Verse 11, and this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. That's the way it is. If you have Jesus Christ, you have life. If you don't have Jesus Christ, you're not alive. You may be living, but you're not alive. You don't have God's life. Verse 13, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. These things I have written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God. All you people who believe on the name of the Son of God, I've written all these things to you so that you may be certain that you have eternal life. People who are believing in Jesus Christ, John says, need to also live in the certainty of having eternal life. If you're saved, you're saved. If you're saved, you're a child of God. If you have a real relationship with God, you have eternal life. He didn't say, I've written these things that you may know you've got 5 minutes in heaven. No, he says, I've written these things that you may know that you have eternal life. It's very simple. And you know what? There isn't any as long as in there. No as long as. As long as you're a good boy or a good girl. As long as you don't sin against the Holy Spirit. As long as you abide. As long as you read the Bible every day. As long as you pray every day. As long as you go witness your faith every day. There's none of those in there. No as long as. I've written these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that you have eternal life. That's it. And that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. Well, he just started that way. Well, he ended that way. When we have confidence in the fact that we have a real relationship with God, and we're not worried about somehow going beyond the line, and that's it, I'm going to lose my salvation. What is that going to do? We're going to believe. We're going to trust in the name of the Son of God. All that does is help us with our relationship with God. Does that make us want to sin? No. John starts off this epistle, he's saying, I've written these things so that you don't sin. But if anybody does sin, we have got an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. And he is a propitiation for our sins, and not our sins only, but also the sins of the whole world. He doesn't give us a question mark. He gives us in this epistle tests to take. That if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you have got no problem passing. In the Greek texts, the present tense is, you could be translated, continues to or practices. So someone who continues to obey God's teachings or practices obeying God's teachings, Jesus' teachings, people who are continuing to love with agape love their brothers and sisters in Christ, people who believe that Jesus Christ is God the Son, they can be certain that they're children of God. They can be certain that they have been changed by God. They can be certain that they have eternal life. But I sin sometimes. Yeah, if anyone does sin, we have an advocate, which is Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is a propitiation for our sins. There isn't anything in this book that's going to make you doubt your salvation unless you're not saved. Because then you haven't passed the test. He doesn't give anybody a false sense of security, because if somebody is continuing in their sin, they haven't passed the test. They're not saved. They're not a child of God. They're not a Christian. If someone doesn't like the brothers and sisters in Christ, doesn't love them, isn't selfless towards them, they haven't passed the test. He doesn't give us a sense of, I would call it morbid self-introspection. Well, I don't know for sure if I'm saved. I don't know if I've been obedient enough. I don't know if I've been loving enough. Well, nobody's going to be obedient enough and loving enough. We're sinners. But as we walk in the light, as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us of all sins. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just, will forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. There is nothing for anyone to doubt their salvation in this little book. But there is absolutely stuff for unbelievers to know that they don't have eternal life, to know that they aren't a real Christian, to know that they are a deceiver, they're a liar, they're an antichrist. John makes it black and white. It's really easy. It's a yes or no. It's not a maybe. Or am I close to being saved? Or am I going to lose my salvation? It's nothing like that. It's that easy. He doesn't make it difficult. And he always rounds off the edges of the questions. And he takes every one of these tests, and then he exhorts us with that text. Test. Because if we're doubting, we need to believe. If we're not obedient, we need to be obedient. If we're not loving, we need to be more loving. So he always exhorts us, encourages us to be even better at passing these tests. But he doesn't make us wonder if we're Christians or not. He makes it very, very simple. So after he said, "These things I have written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God." Then he goes on, verse 14. "And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him." So now he connects, because it starts with the word "and." And it connects with verse 13. 14 and 13 are connected with that word "and," which means it's a continuation of the thought. "And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us." Well, we believe that we have eternal life because we believe in the Son of God. That is an amazing amount of confidence. Somebody who knows they're saved is the person I want praying for me. Someone who's not sure if they're saved or not, are they gonna have any confidence? Are they gonna ask with confidence? No, because they're always gonna wonder, well, you know, maybe God doesn't like me, or maybe I didn't repent enough. I mean, there's a lot of people that say, well, you know, you gotta make sure when you're praying that you gotta confess all known sins or God's not gonna hear you. Well, that comes from a denominational background of you got to keep coming forward every Sunday to get saved. Because somehow you sin and then you lose your salvation. That's not what the Bible teaches. It makes it really clear that we can have confidence. So he says, and this is the confidence, that's the boldness. In the Greek, it means like freedom of speech, so to speak. So if you were a Greek, if you were a Roman citizen, you could stand in the marketplace and you could, as a citizen, say whatever your opinion was, legally, because you're a citizen. That you had that right. That's kind of where this comes from. Well, confidence is being able to tell Jesus anything. If you're not sure if you're saved, are you going to have confidence to tell God anything? Because what are you looking at? You're looking at yourself for salvation. You're saying, well, I'm not quite good enough. Well, I sinned this week. Well, I know I shouldn't have done it, and I was really weak, and I did it, and now God's not going to like me, so he's not going to listen to me. If our salvation is based on us, we're not going to have any confidence to pray. But he says, no, our confidence is in him. We can know that we have eternal life. And because we can know we have eternal life, we've got amazing amount of confidence. Our life in Christ isn't just for eternity. It isn't just heaven. It's right now. Having confidence that we have eternal life means that I can just come to God right now and talk to him about anything. I don't have to worry what if he's going to like what I have to say or if I'm going to say it wrong. There is a lot of Gnosticism that has come into the church dealing with prayer. And it has shattered people's confidence in God. So people think, well, I can't say a negative profession because then the bad thing's going to happen to me. As though you are sovereign in the universe and you're God and you can make bad things happen by proclaiming them to be. If you're a witch, you believe that. As a Christian, you should not be believing something like that. Well, it's got to be positive. Only think positive thoughts. You're driving yourself crazy. The Bible doesn't teach anything like that. Anywhere. But false teachers have come into the Christian church and have gotten people very confused. And have added this. That's not what John says. No. You can know that you have eternal life, and because you know you have eternal life, you can have the confidence. You can ask him anything. If we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. There's people who, when they pray, it's a really hard work for them because they've got this huge list. that they have accumulated from certain false teachers. And anything that they could possibly be worried about, they got to make sure they pray against that. And so they have this written down prayer of all this stuff that they're praying against for everybody that they know in themselves. So that doesn't happen. And if you perchance are sleepy or something and you lift one of those things out, well, that bad thing might happen to the one you love or yourself. Is that the way your Heavenly Father deals with you? Really? Is that the way it is? I mean, you trust your dad, right? And if you asked him for something, but left something out, is he going to punish you because you left something out of what you asked him? No. He's going to give you what? What he knows is best for you because he loves you. Right? I mean, you know that. That's the confidence we have talking to God. He knows what's best for us. Are we going to ask for the wrong things? Absolutely. Why? Because we're just a bunch of little kids. That all we can think about is the here and now. We don't know what's going to happen. We can ask for a bunch of things that's really, really important to us. But we are not omniscient. We don't know what to pray against so that it doesn't happen. Because we don't know how bizarre the mind is of Satan, who's got all these horrible schemes to destroy us. He's so much smarter of all these concoctions of all kinds of things that we can never even imagine how horrible it would be to us. We can't ask to make sure that doesn't happen because we don't know all the things he can come up with to destroy us. But our Heavenly Father knows. And he's going to protect us. If we leave something out of a prayer, it's not going to be a big deal. Because we can't think of everything that has to be in that prayer. All we know is our own little experience. But there's all kinds of stuff that could happen that we could forget to put in a prayer. Oh no, I forgot about the asteroid that could come and wreck my car. Oh no, what's going to happen now? You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's ridiculous. No, we've got a really good Heavenly Father who's in charge of the entire universe. And he's omniscient. And he knows every single plan that Satan's got for us for tomorrow. And he has sent his holy angels to take charge over us. We're not in charge of the angels. God is, praise God. But I've heard this teaching. Oh, well, my friend was really in trouble, so I dispatched my angel to go help him. You really don't want to be without an angel on this planet. That would be a very unwise thing to do. So, God doesn't put that in our hands to do. Is that in the Bible somewhere to go dispatch your angel? Of course not. There isn't any passage in the Bible that says that we are in charge of angels. God is. They are God's servants. They're not our servants. God sends them. Because he sees the unseen realm. We don't. But when we know that we're going to go to heaven because we placed our faith in Jesus Christ, we have confidence. God has taken care of the worst issue of our being. And that was our permanent separation from God because of our own sin. God took care of that by sending his son Jesus in our place. Jesus was obedient for us when we couldn't be, and he was punished for every bad thing we would ever do. We have confidence. We can know we're going to go to heaven. We can know that we have eternal life. And in this confidence, we can pray. And we can know that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. That's not just, okay, I got a get out of hell free card in my back pocket. Now I can go live my life and everything's okay. He connects our security eternally with prayer, with our right now relationship with God. He started off this book talking about what it means to have unhindered fellowship with God. And at the end of this little book, he's talking about what that unhindered fellowship means. We have confidence in prayer. We can talk to God about anything. We have freedom of speech. We can just say anything. What if I ask for the wrong thing? Well, praise God, I've asked for all kinds of wrong things, and he said no, praise God. There's all kinds of stuff I really, 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 really wanted that, praise God, weren't his will. If we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. It's funny. I was in an elevator day before yesterday. And I'm just waiting, to go to the next floor or whatever. And there was this thing about, if there is some kind of fire or whatever, or you can pick it up and or push the button or whatever. And it says, when the light's blinking, you know you've been answered. Like, oh yeah, Lord. Lord, make this light blink. I want to know that you're hearing me. I mean, isn't that what stupid things go through a little child's brain like me? Just do something so I know that you really like me. So I know you're listening to me. Well, John knows that. So he says, I've written these things for you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you can know that you have eternal life. And having this security, and this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. You don't got to wait for that little light to blink to know if he's answered. Is somebody listening on the other line? Now we have this kind of confidence. We've got this kind of confidence. I've got a little handout here about prayer. And the first half is up by George Mueller. George Mueller said, prayer is not overcoming God's reluctance. It is laying hold of God's willingness. So I thought that was kind of nice. So we've got the five conditions of prevailing prayer from George Mueller. And then this next section is comes out of R.A. Torrey's book, How to Pray. And it gives you all the reasons why a prayer isn't answered. Let's see, I'll hand these out here. I'm not going to go through this sheet, but I just want everybody to have them. Anyway, you can look through them and look up the Bible passages. And then the bottom is just a bunch of other, some of it duplicates what's already in there, but it's other confidences and things that we have or don't, why we, anyway. God listens to us. Because we are his children. And we have confidence. We can have confidence. We don't have to wonder. Now I say this because when things are bad, we can believe that, oh, all my prayers are hitting the ceiling and not going any further. Because our emotions are telling us different. When it doesn't feel like God is answering. Well, it doesn't matter how we feel. And as I said before, the emotions follow a thought. It's the way it always has been. We're feeling a feeling, and why are we feeling that feeling? Why are we happy? Well, we got to backtrack and find out what thing was convenient, what thing was pleasurable to make me feel happy now. Why am I angry? Well, you chose to be angry because something didn't meet your expectations, or some person didn't meet your expectations, and you got to go back to that point of how you had that expectation and why was it not met, and why are you angry now? You don't all of a sudden, oh, I have this emotion. Well, because you have this emotion, now you can't think thoughts clearly because your thoughts are now based on how you feel. Well, prayer has nothing to do with how we feel. It has only to do with the promise of God. And it doesn't matter if it doesn't seem like God is listening. Why? Because he's a very good father. And we have confidence to say anything we want. What if I said something outside of his will? Then he said something outside of his will. Does it make him less your heavenly father? No. But it doesn't feel like it. Doesn't matter how it feels. Only has to do with what God has already said to be true. Verse 15. And if we know that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that that we desired of him. I don't see anything about feelings there. But a lot of people, they're convinced that they got to work up their faith to believe something. And they get themselves really fired up. No different than, I mean, there's lots of motivational speakers out there. And it's like the cheerleaders getting everybody worked up, and they're all excited. We're going to go win the game, and everybody's all fired up because we're so fired up. Our emotions are going to give us the momentum to go win that game. Is that how people win the game? No, it's never been how anybody's won the game. Either you're more skilled and more strong and more qualified, or you're not. It's not because you got yourself all worked up. I mean, there's a story of a guy who his pastor was convinced that he could work himself up in the faith of believing to walk on water. And so he got himself all excited and worked up, and he had his friends around, and he was going to walk across the pool. And he was doing this for the glory of Jesus. And he stepped in and fell in the water. And of course, the whole thing was a failure, and he felt really bad. But he was convinced that he could work up himself enough faith to believe. We're not talking about some weird occultic thing. We're talking about a real relationship with God. You're talking to your Heavenly Father, and you're talking to Him about stuff. And you're saying, Lord, I got this request. And if it's your will, then answer it. And if we know that He hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of Him. It's not rocket science. I mean, it's really not that difficult. And it's not about me working up myself into an emotional state of confidence. But there's a lot of folks out there that, you know, they're Christians, and they get people all fired up, and they're really excited about doing something. But have they just worked themselves up emotionally to move forward on a false expectation? Or have they really prayed? It's John doesn't make it difficult. He makes it really easy. It's not about us. Our faith is not based on us. Our faith is based in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. That's it. Faith is not faith in faith. Faith is faith in Jesus. The object of our faith is Jesus. Why can I have confidence before God? Because God became a human, and He lived a life that I was incapable of living, so that His death on the cross would be the perfect sacrifice for my sins. And He rose from the dead, victorious over my sin, victorious over the devil, and victorious over death. And because of that, I respond in love. Because of that, I know God loves me, because He's proved it greater than any human being could ever prove love to me. And I've got confidence that because He lives, I live. And I'm going to live. And if we know that He hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of Him. That sounds like a blank check. Yes, it is. The Bible says it right there. That's how simple it is. It's a blank check. Right in the amount. But if it's not God's will, you're not going to get it. Well, you know what? If it's God's will for Him to give you $1 million, He will. But most of the time, He won't. Why? Because you're going to have something in place of God. But if I had $1 million, I wouldn't have to worry. What are you worrying about now? You've got the sustainer and the creator of the universe, and He's holding your hand so that you don't fall headlong. I mean, what? You got something to worry about now? Yeah, but it's like paycheck to paycheck. It's like, I don't know. I mean, I can't. There's all kinds of... He's going to give you something that's going to cause you to live independently from Him? No, He's keeping you in a place where you're going to be desperately dependent in Him, because it's the only safe place for you to be in the universe. It's right there, holding on tight. That's where He wants you to be. He knows what you like. He knows what you'll delight in. He knows things that you want, and He knows what things that you want are going to separate you from Him. And He loves you too much to give you everything you want. Praise God. You know, He, as a good shepherd, He's going to lead us down through the valley of the shadow of death. You think that's a nice place to be? No. But He is the one who's next to you. He's holding your hand. When He leads you by these lush, verdant valleys filled with all these yummy, edible things for nice sheepies to eat, or if He leads you right by the quiet waters, does He lead you there so He can go and, you know, go watch a movie somewhere or go out for pizza? No, He's there watching all the time. And when He leads you through the valley of the shadow of death, it's so that you are going to draw as close to Him as you can get and to take you to some place that He wants you to be. Is He going to say yes to every one of our prayers? The ones in His will. But there are some false teachers out there that will tell you, do not pray, not my will but thine be done. Because you just cancel out your prayer. Now that's ridiculous when you say it like that, but that's exactly what they're teaching. And one of those guys is Kenneth Hagin. Another one is Charles Capps. Another one is Kenneth Copeland. If you've got any of these books, throw them away. Because they're false teachers. They're liars. They're deceivers. They teach things that are not in the Bible. They're teaching things that come from witchcraft. Are we creators? Are we calling things into being? Witches believe that. That's not what the Bible teaches anywhere. Show me a passage that says that we can call stuff into being. No, what does the Bible talk about? It talks about us having a real relationship with the one and only Creator. Why in the world would we want to believe that we could call things into being? This universe is messed up enough as it is because of our sin. Do you think God would give us the ability to screw it up completely by calling things into being? Of course not. But the devil can't create anything. All he can do is wreck what God created. So he's trying to wreck people's relationships with God by false teachers. Do we have confidence to ask for anything and have the confidence to know that we've received it? Absolutely, when it's God's will. And when Jesus says, not my will but thine be done, he's saying, Father, let your will be done and I'm going to submit to it. He didn't say, not my will, but he didn't say, my will and thy will be changed. Are we trying to change God's will? We're trying to change God's opinion? We're not smart enough. We're not omniscient. We really don't want to do that if it were even possible. And praise God, it's not possible. But people have gone way beyond what the Bible teaches. And if we know that He hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of Him. We can have that kind of confidence. We can ask for anything, absolutely. Are we going to offend God to ask for something that God doesn't want us to have? No, He'll just say no. I mean, it's not a big deal. He knows that we don't see everything. He knows that we don't know everything. He's going to give us what we need. And you know what? He gives us what we really like. And He gives us stuff that we don't know that we actually would like it more than what we really were asking for. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff that we thought we really, 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 really had to have. And God said, no, because you're not going to like it anyway. It's just going to get stacked someplace. It's going to get stored somewhere. And you'll have it, but you're never going to enjoy it. I want to give you what you're really going to enjoy. I don't want to give you something you're just going to store in a garage someplace. But He gives us a lot of stuff that we've just stored in a garage someplace. Because he knew that we really wanted him. That's how good a dad he is. But we have this kind of confidence in prayer. Now he goes on from this point and now is talking about something that's more important than just me wanting what I really want. Me getting what I really want. Verse 16. If any man sees his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. There is a sin unto death, and I do not say that he shall pray for it. All unrighteousness is sin, and there is a sin not unto death. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and the wicked one toucheth him not. Okay. Now, in the context of praying, and praying having full confidence that God is hearing us and he will give us what we are asking for, he now says, what's the most important thing to pray about? Well, somebody else's relationship with God. When you know that there is something that is hindering your relationship with God. He is saying, if any man see his brother sin a sin. Okay? He says brother. In the context of 1 John, how does he use this word brother? It means a brother and sister in Christ. It means a fellow Christian. It means a believer. He's not talking about somebody else who's not saved. So I just want to make that point clear. If anyone see his brother sin a sin, which is not unto death, he shall ask and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. So in other words, you see somebody who is... They've got some issues. They're struggling in a certain area. And you pray for them. And God's going to bring them to repentance. Example. In the upper room, Jesus says, you're all going to leave me tonight. And Peter says, if all these guys leave you, I love you far more than all these other guys. I'll never leave you, Lord. And what does Jesus tell Peter? Simon, Simon, Satan has demanded to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you that you will not fall. And when you have repented, comfort your brothers. That is an example of what we see right here. Peter denied his faith. He denied Jesus. Now, he did it three times. Which is basically what you would do to divorce your wife. Is to publicly deny that person, publicly disown that person. He basically denied and disowned Jesus Christ. And after it happened, Peter and John happened to be there in the courtyard watching the goings on there, and somehow as Jesus was being led from one courtroom to another, after he had denied him the third time, Jesus looked at Peter. And, you know, there's all kinds of different opinions of what that looked like. But for the simple fact was that Jesus already had told Peter what he was going to do. You can't tell me that it was, I can't believe you did that, Peter. Oh, you hurt my, you broke my heart. What? No, I'm so offended. No, you can't tell me that. It's like, remember, Peter, I prayed for you. So what did Peter do? He went out and wept bitterly. But he didn't despair. Judas betrayed Jesus. And he confessed his sin. And he tried to make amends. And he threw that money that he got back into the temple. But repentance wasn't finished because he never placed his faith in Jesus Christ. And he despaired and killed himself. Peter didn't despair and kill himself. Why? Because Jesus prayed for him that he wouldn't fall. But I prayed for you, Peter. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. There's a lot of folks in our life that we know and love, and they're brothers and sisters in Christ, and they are playing around with sin, and they are close to self-destruction, and we are praying and we are fasting that God is going to grant them repentance, and God's going to answer. He's going to give them life. Doesn't mean that there's not going to be consequences, because God is not mocked. Whatever we sow, we reap. But God's going to bring them back to Himself. And how many people do you know in your life who you've prayed for, and you don't know how to pray for them, and they've returned. They've come back to the Lord. The same confidence that we can ask God anything, we can ask God about this. Lord, look at what's going on. Lord, grant them repentance. Lord, take them out of the snare that the devil has used to hold them captive. Lord, bring them to them to their senses. And we think about Jesus' parable of, you know, the prodigal son. He said, I don't want to hang around with you, Dad. I just want all the stuff that's coming to me for being your kid. And then he went out and he lived this life of riotous living, and he burned up all of his funds and bars and prostitutes and all that kind of stuff. So what happened? He finally came to his senses in the pig pen. He's starving. And he's got the only job he could get, which was feeding pigs. And he is coveting the food that the pigs are eating. It's like, you know, these beans aren't too bad. Plucking the beans off the trees and feeding them to the pigs. Like, you know, they're not horrible. And he's starving. Says, you know, my dad's slaves had it far better than I do. I'm gonna go back. And I'm just going to say, okay, I'm a slave. You know, treat me as a slave. I don't care. I'll work for you because life is better here. The moment his father saw him at a distance, his father ran and embraced him. He didn't say, okay, yeah, you can serve me for the rest of my life, the rest of your life as a slave. No, what did he do? He put on the rings, he put on the coat, he restored him completely to everything that he left as being a son. Kill the fatted calf. My son who is dead is alive. That's the way it is with every sinner that repents. Just waiting. He didn't go send his son money so that he could stop working in the pig pen. No, he let him in the pig pen until he came to his senses. And you know what? That's what it takes. Don't despise the pig pen. Got some good things happening out in that pig pen. Lots of people come to their senses down there. I don't know if you know anything about pigs, but you know, I'm from Wisconsin, and you know, you're driving down a city road, and it's very nice, you got the windows open, but boy, when you drive by where they're, oh man, that's horrid. It just makes you want to gag when you're driving by, it's that bad. That's what life is like, feeding pigs. It's not going to be pleasant at all. You know, there's the illustration of, you know, a sheep can fall down in the mud. And the sheep can even fall into the pig slop. But it doesn't like it because it's a sheep. A pig likes it because it's a pig. A pig is not a sheep. The son, when he left his father, did he stop being a son? He was always a son. The moment he turned back, his father was waiting for him. He never stopped being a son. When someone is in sin, away from God, does it make them no longer a Christian? They're still a Christian. They're still a child of God. God has not just changed their identity, He changed their character. They are born again. They're born from above. They got the Holy Spirit indwelling them. Are they having a good time in the pig pen? The most miserable folks I have ever met, that you probably met too, are people who are saved, who are living in sin. Their life is miserable. They don't think they're saved. They're near despair all the time. But they absolutely are saved. But they're far more miserable than a sinner who's always sinned and feels good about their sin. They don't feel good about their sin because they aren't a pig. They're a sheep. They never stop being a sheep. They never stop being a child of God. A child of their father. But they're, you know, they're... Sin has a pleasure for a season. And pretty soon the season wears off and you start paying the consequences for the sin. In Hebrews 12, you know, whoever wrote it, probably Paul, I think, he makes it really clear that whoever God receives as a child, he spanks. Why? Because he cares more about our holiness than we do. He cares more about our righteousness than we do. He cares more about our testimony as a Christian than we do. He cares more about our eternal reward than we do. And so he spanks us. Praise God, he's a good dad. It's the loving hand of discipline. And it has its effect. And if somebody is getting away with sin without being spanked, they're an illegitimate child. They're not a child. They're getting away with it. Well, most of the people who are the most miserable are the folks who are children of God who are continuing in sin and are really miserable. They're not getting away with it. And they know they're not getting away with it. And as they sin, they know God is watching them do it. And so, John says, if any man sees his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask. And he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. Then he goes on, there is a sin unto death, and I do not say that he shall pray for it. Now, that's really scary. What does that mean? Well, that means you can lose your salvation, right? It means you can lose eternal life, right? Then it wouldn't be eternal life if you could lose it. Then it wouldn't be salvation if you could lose it. That you could lose your sonship? Is that what it's saying? No, there is sin unto death. The thing is that word brother sees his brother sin a sin. We're not talking about an unbeliever. An unbeliever is going to stay an unbeliever until he gets saved. Or until they live their life the same way and they die the death that they're going to get for living their life that way. It's not talking about that. It's talking about a brother, a sister in Christ. And there's a sin unto death. Wow, that's kind of. Well, I think it's Acts chapter 5. It talks about Ananias and Sapphira. They, you know, we just talked about, you know, Barnabas. He had this piece of property. And he saw the great need in Jerusalem for the believers. Why was there a great need? Well, because as soon as somebody got saved, they were ostracized from the Jewish community. They couldn't go to the temple, they couldn't go to the synagogue, they were like excommunicated, if we want to call it that. But they were kicked out of their family for being a Christian. Their family basically would have a funeral service and they no longer existed. Your business could no longer make money because the Jews weren't going to, you know, your countrymen would have disowned you. Your boss would have fired you. So there's a lot of poor people. And so Barnabas, he sold this piece of property. He wasn't using it, but all these people needed food in their stomachs. Well, here's Ananias and Sapphira. They had a piece of property, so they sold it. And they thought, well, we're not going to give all the money to the church, but we're going to hold back some. Because we want to still live our lifestyle that we've got, you know, but we'll just say that so they made an agreement. Well, Ananias shows up and he lies to Peter. And Peter says, you haven't lied to me, you've lied to the Holy Spirit. Because you told me that this is what the property was sold for, but it was sold for more. While the property was in your hands, you could have kept it or sold it. It was all up to you. It belonged to you. You could do whatever you want. But to lie to God? And he dropped dead right there. Oh, he was supposed to give all the money to God and then he wouldn't have died? No, he could have kept the property. He could have sold it. He could have done whatever. It belonged to him. He had full sovereignty over that piece of property. He could have done anything, but the simple fact was he wanted to look good. He wanted to be honored as much as Barnabas was honored for selling a piece of property and giving all the money to the church. Well, then Sapphira shows up and she wants to start getting the praise. Like, hey, where's my husband? So she shows up, and so Peter says, how much was that property sold for? And she lied. Says, well, the young men who buried your husband are on their way to bury you. And she dropped dead there too. It wasn't about the gift, it was about the lie. They didn't have to give any money to the church and they'd still be okay with God and okay with the church, but they wanted to look good and still have their lifestyle intact. Well, they lied to God. And God killed them. So Ananias and Sapphira went to hell? They lost their salvation? No, I think they were believers. They were just disobedient and God killed them. Doesn't say they went to hell. Just says that God killed them. And fear came upon the church. Why? Because all of a sudden you're taking God seriously. You're not going to live like a hypocrite. Because you're taking God seriously. You're taking God's word seriously. Well, in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul has heard from the Corinthians, and there was this guy who was living in a sexual relationship with his stepmom. And he says, you know, even the unbelievers don't have this kind of lifestyle. And you're allowing this guy who is living in unrepentant sin to... He's got good standing in the church? Oh, well, you know, we're a grace-based church. You know, it's all about grace, you know. We understand he's struggling in this area. We're just extending him grace. And he says, kick him out. In fact, stay away from all these people who claim to be brothers and sisters in Christ, but they're pursuing some kind of sin. Stay away from them. He says, I'm not telling you to stay away from everybody who does all these sins, who is, you know, they're cheaters and they're adulterers and all these other things, because you'd have to stay out of the world. Well, that can't happen. I'm just saying, stay away from people who call themselves Christians who are pursuing sin. And he says, I've given this guy over to Satan. Let me read what he says so I don't say it wrong. The words that Paul says in 1 Corinthians 5:5. To deliver such and one unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Is this guy losing his salvation? Why in the world would he say his spirit be saved if his spirit isn't to be saved? He's saved. But he's living in unrepentant sin. He's practicing sin. He's continuing in sin. He says, I've given this one over to Satan for the destruction of his flesh. Well, when you play the devil's playground, it's not going to be pleasant. When you live in an area devoid of the blessings of God, when God's people say, I'm sorry, you're acting like an unbeliever, so I'm going to treat you as an unbeliever. It's not going to be pleasant. He is not condoning sin. He is not doing anything to enable them in their sin. It says, you want to live in sin? If you want to live under the authority of Satan, then I'm giving you over to the authority of Satan, and Satan can just tear up your life so that your spirit's going to be saved on the day of the Lord Jesus. You're going to go to heaven, but you are going to have a living hell on this life. It's not going to be very pleasant giving you over. He's not saying, I'm kicking you into hell. No, I'm giving you over for the destruction. Let Satan have his work in you. You like living under his authority and not being under the authority of Jesus Christ? Then spend your life there until you're done with it. I'm sure he had a horrible, miserable time. And when we got into 2 Corinthians, you know, it might have been a year or 2 years after this guy was kicked out of the church, and he says, you know, it's enough. It's enough. Restore him as a brother. He's repented. You know, we're not unaware of the devil's schemes. So receive him back as a brother. He's repented. He's not doing it anymore. His spirit got saved and it didn't end his life. Well, in 1 Corinthians, there's lots of issues in that church. And so he was pushing them hard. He was telling them stuff that wasn't easy to hear. And in chapter 11, Paul is talking about their misuse of the Lord's Supper. And so the words that we use when we take the Lord's Supper are the words that Jesus himself gave to Paul. And Paul says, what I received from the Lord, I give to you. And so the words that we use when we take the Lord's Supper are the same words that are recorded for us in Luke. And they're right here, because I'm sure Luke got it from Paul. Are right here in 1 Corinthians 11. But in these instructions of taking the Lord's Supper, he's saying, you know, what you're taking is not the Lord's Supper, because you guys are just having this big potluck and you're eating all the good food, and then people are leaving hungry, and some people are drinking the wine and they're getting drunk. I mean, and then you have this is not the Lord's Supper you're taking. And then he gave him clear instructions of what the Lord's Supper is. He says in verse 28 of 1 Corinthians, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Well, people were misusing the Lord's Supper, and so they were being chastened of the Lord. It doesn't mean damnation, mean going to hell. It means being judged by God. They were chastened of the Lord. And the chastening made some people weak, some people sickly, and some sleep. That means if you fall asleep in church, that's God's judgment against you. No, it's talking about death, because when a Christian in the New Testament dies, they call it sleep. It's not soul sleep. No, you're very much alert and awake. I mean, just look in the book of Revelation for the martyrs who are there under the throne. They know what's going on. They're not sleeping. But it's called sleep. Why? Because when a Christian dies, it's no different than us putting our head on the pillow and closing our eyes and falling asleep. Because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. It's a peaceful thing. And if you've seen people die, some that are Christians and some that aren't, you can tell the difference. No, there's a judgment of people who are misusing the Lord's Supper, and some of them died. It was a earthly chastisement. God ended their life. Why? Well, because God knew. God knew that if they stayed alive, they would cause more damage to the church. If they stayed alive, they'd cause more abuse to fellow Christians, fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. God knew that if they stayed alive, they would more hurt the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ by their lifestyle. So God ended their life. And so John says here, there is a sin unto death. And I do not say that he shall pray for it. Verse 17, all unrighteousness is sin, and there is a sin not unto death. Well, the wages of sin is death. I mean, everybody's going to die because we are all sinners. But he's talking about some specific sin that is going to end in death as the chastisement of the Lord. So what is that? How far can you go before God smites you? I don't know. I don't have an answer. Because John doesn't make it clear, we got commentators all over the board here saying, well, it must be talking about they lost their salvation. But then why did he use the word brother? It's not talking about unbelievers who have sinned against the Holy Spirit and can't be saved because they don't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, because it's talking about brother. Well, if some people continue in sin, there's going to be consequences. And the ultimate consequence that God could do is say, it's over. Well, in 1 Corinthians 3, Paul is talking about the rewards that we get. Whatever we've done on this world, whatever we've done while we're here, basically, it's all going to be set on fire. And whatever remains, whatever is built on the foundation of the Lord Jesus Christ, whatever remains, that's the reward. Did you build with wood, hay, and stubble? Or did you build with precious stones and precious metals? If you built with precious stones and precious metals, that will remain. So in other words, God is going to judge the motives of everybody's heart. Are they doing it to make themselves look good? Are they doing it to look successful in the eyes of the world? Are they doing it for their own glory and their own fame? Or are they doing it for the glory and fame of the Lord Jesus Christ? If it's for the fame of Jesus Christ, you're building with precious stones and precious metals. And when it's all set on fire, you're going to receive the reward. But if it was all about you and what you want, and your own selfish lifestyle, it's all going to burn up. But he says that they'll be saved, but as a man escaping through the flames. Somebody running out of a burning building and their clothes are on fire. So they run down on the grass and they roll around and put their clothes out. That's all they've got. They're saved. So for an eternity, you've got nothing to show for your love for your Redeemer. Or if you have built to the glory of Jesus Christ for His fame, you have been building with precious stones and with precious metals, and there'll be an eternal reward. Jesus makes the parable of people who have been given talents, and then when their Lord returns, some were given two, some were given five, some were given one. Well, the one who was given one, he was hoping he could use it for himself and thinking maybe his master wouldn't return, so he buried it in the ground. But the one with two says, hey, I made an extra two with the two you gave me. And the one who made five, hey, I made an extra five with the five you gave me. And what does the master do? Take away the one from the one who didn't do anything and give it to the one with ten. To one who has, more will be given. And he says, I'm giving you the responsibility of 10 cities or 11 cities. I'm giving you the responsibility of 4 cities. There is a correlation as we rule and reign with Christ according to how faithful we've been with what He's given us in this life. If we've been faithful to use whatever it is that He's given us to His glory, He's going to make us more responsible in life to come. It's not about getting more stuff for us to live a selfish life. No, the selfish life is the one that burns up and they've got nothing to show. It's a selfless life where a person has given themselves and everything that God has placed in their hands, he's used it to the glory of God. That's the person who's going to receive a greater responsibility in the millennium as we rule and reign with Christ. So, anyway, there is a sin unto death. If someone's going to live a life completely selfish, there's going to be consequences. And so he says, I don't want you to pray about that. For having this great thing of all this confidence that we have that, yes, I've got eternal life and I know that I'm going to go to heaven and there's nothing anybody can do about it. And now he says, there's a sin unto death. What is he saying? He's doing what he's been doing through this whole book. He keeps cinching up the edges so that people are going to say, oh, well, I've got grace. I can go do whatever I want. I'm still going to go to heaven. Well, there's going to be consequences. He doesn't give people the right to sin. He's not enabling sin. He's not condoning sin. He says, no, if there's a sin unto death, they're going to die. And he says, I don't even want you praying for them. Do you mean God would want you to not pray for somebody? You know, in the book of Jeremiah, I think it's four times, God told Jeremiah, don't pray for those guys. I'm not going to listen. You're wasting your time. You're wasting my time. I'm not going to listen. I'm not listening, Jeremiah. La, 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 la. You can pray all you want, but these guys are in rebellion against me, and I'm not going to listen to that prayer. So this isn't anything new about God. This is the way He is. If someone is continuing to live as though Jesus is not their Lord, but they got Jesus as their Savior in the back pocket, says they're sinning unto death. Don't pray for them, because I'm not going to listen. So he doesn't say, okay, it's a blank check for everything. It is a blank check as long as it's in God's will. We're not changing God's mind. We are coming into the realization what God's will really is. So if you are in a boat and you threw a grappling hook or your anchor onto the shore of an island, and you start pulling on the rope of that anchor, are you pulling the island closer to yourself? No, you're pulling your boat closer to the island. That's what prayer is. And we learn God's will as we pray, because we are getting ourselves aligned with God's will. It's a really interesting study as you study Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. If you read all the accounts, He's saying, not my will, but thine be done. But the first thing He says, if it is not your will. Well, obviously it was the Father's will for Jesus to bear the burden of sin for the world. But Jesus had no sin. It's unnatural for Him to die. He is God. It's unnatural for God to die. He always did everything according to the Father's will. It didn't make any sense. And so Jesus is sweating great drops of blood in the Garden of Gethsemane, and God sends an angel to comfort him in his prayer. Jesus brought himself under the perfect will of God the Father in prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane. I can't understand that. But he brought himself there by praying. Now that's real prayer. Verse 18. We know that whatsoever is born of God sinneth not. Uh-oh, I've sinned. That means I'm not a child of God. Well, it's in the present tense, which means continues to sin or practices sin. We know that whatsoever is born of God does not practice sin, does not continue sin. Are we going to sin? We're going to sin. But we're not practicing sin. A person who is continuing in sin is not proving that he's a child of God. He's proving that he's not a child of God. But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself. A real child of God, one who is begotten of God, is keeping himself. He's keeping himself pure, just like we read in chapter 3. Beloved, now we are the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when He shall appear, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. And every man that hath this hope in Him, in himself, purifieth himself, even as He is pure. And now He says, keepeth himself. A person who is a child of God is living a life trying to keep the commandments, trying to do what is right in God's sight, trying to love more, because you got God working on the inside, giving you the want to and the ability to do what is right in God's sight. He that is begotten of God keepeth himself. And then it says, and the wicked one toucheth him not. The wicked one touches him not. So if you're a Christian, then you never have to worry about the devil anymore? Is that what John's saying, right? The word touch in the Greek basically means to grab a hold of. The same word is what Mary Magdalene did when she saw the resurrected Jesus. And he said, touch me not. It doesn't mean, ooh, don't touch me. She was grabbing onto him with a death grip. You left me once, Lord. I'm never going to leave you again. She was like grabbing a hold of him. He would have been dragging her around wherever he went. No, he says, don't keep grabbing a hold of me, because I need to return to my Father. Why? Because once he ascended into heaven, all authority in heaven and earth is going to be given to him. But she needed to see that Jesus was alive, because she went to his tomb to see a dead Jesus, and a dead Jesus wasn't there. No, Jesus was alive. So what John is saying is, the devil doesn't grab a hold of you. In other words, the devil has not got a death grip on you. Does the devil touch us? Oh yeah. He tempts us. He tortures us. He does all kinds of bad stuff. That's his job. That's what he likes to do. I mean, if you read the book of Job, because God allowed the devil to do it, he didn't tell the devil to do it, but the devil was aching to try to make life a living hell for Job. The Apostle Paul himself, once we get to chapter 12 in 2 Corinthians, he says that a minister of Satan had given him this thorn in the flesh. A minister of Satan. He was being demonized by a demon was torturing Saul, the Apostle Paul's body, to the point where he could not function. No, the devil does touch us, but he doesn't grab a hold with a death grip and not release. Why? Because we are being held onto by Jesus. And Jesus says, none can snatch you out of my hand. The Father, who is greater than all, who has given you to me, none can snatch out of his hand. I and the Father are one. That's some pretty strong language. That's who's holding on tight to us. The devil is not going to hold on tight to us. Whoever is begotten of God keepeth himself, and the wicked one toucheth him not. Doesn't grab a hold and never let go. Might feel like that. The devil might tell us that that's the case, but it's a lie. Verse 20, and we know that the Son of God is come and hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. We know that Jesus Christ is God the Son. That is true. He is true. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And that's all right here in verse 20. The Son is come. You could say in the Greek, the Son is coming. In some translations it says, the Son has come. Well, he who was and is to come. He's coming. And he has come. We know that the Son of God has come and hath given us an understanding. We know who God is. We know who Jesus Christ is. That he is God. That he is God the Son. That we may know him that is true. Jesus came so that we could know God. In John's epistle, John says it really clearly. That Jesus came to explain the Father to us. The word exegesis comes from that word explain that John uses. He exposited God the Father to us by everything that Jesus said and everything that Jesus did. And because of that, we have an understanding of God. We wouldn't know God if God didn't come in the flesh. There's no way we could possibly have an understanding of God if he didn't take our place. There's no way we could understand what true love was if he hadn't have died in our place. And we know him that is true. It's not a maybe. We know. We absolutely know. We have the certainty who he is and that he is true. And we are in him that is true. We're in him. Now that's a big deal. We're not on the outside trying to hold on. I'm going to hold on tight to you, Jesus, as long as I can, with all my might, and I just hope I don't slip off. No, that's not it. We are in Him. We are in Christ. Now, Paul uses that kind of analogy a lot, more than John does. But here, we are in Him. Well, he says He's come to indwell us. He's in us. But we are in Him. And it's not like, oh, yeah, we're in Jesus' heart. He thinks about us all the time. No, we are in Him. That's the only way that we get to heaven. That's the only reason why we've got any righteousness to actually stand before God. Because we are going to be found in Christ. God looks at us and He's going to see us with all the righteousness of His Son, Jesus Christ. We're not accepted on the basis of us and our goodness, or all our specialness, or all our prettiness, or our smartness, or all strongness. We're accepted in Christ. We are in Christ. Everything that we have, everything about our relationship with God is there because we are in Christ. That is true. That is true. That's what the truth is. And you know what? If we don't feel like it, if we don't, if we think that I'm not sure if I'm saved or not, it doesn't make any difference. The truth is still the truth. It doesn't matter how we feel about it. I can feel really good about my salvation because I just did something neat for God. I just shared my faith and somebody prayed to receive the Lord. And I'm on cloud nine and I know I'm going to heaven. And tomorrow I'm going to fall into the same sin that I keep on falling into and I'm going to wonder if I'm saved or not. Nothing changed from yesterday to today or tomorrow. It doesn't matter how I feel. The truth is still the truth. Well, why was he talking about the truth so much? Because you've got these Gnostics over here who are saying you only get eternal life by coming under our authority and coming under our teaching and understanding the Bible our special way. And we've got all these special ways of understanding every verse of the Bible. And it's only through the special knowledge that you're going to know that you have eternal life. And every single one of these false teachers has got things that they have infused into verses of the Bible that were never put there by God. If you need their book to understand the Bible, I don't think it's the truth. Now, I'm not against study Bibles, but you got to know who's the one who put those notes there. I mean, I've got a MacArthur study Bible. There's a lot of really good notes there, but he's a cessationist. He'll tell you that all the gifts of the Holy Spirit are not for today. It was all finished when the canon of the Scriptures were written. And it's all over. And you'll see it over and over again. It just makes you angry. If you've got a Dake study Bible, you're going to read the Dake study Bible and there, every single passage that would give you assurance of your salvation is going to be reworded so that you're not sure if you're actually going to make it or not. If you've got a Dake study Bible, throw it away. I mean, this friend of mine, he went to this one singles retreat for a different church, and he won, you know, he had, you know, the right number, and he got it, and it was beautiful. It was genuine leather, and it was a beautiful, smell nice, gold thing with the edges and the tabs, and beautiful Bible. So I thought, well, I'm going to go turn over to 1 John 5:13 to find out what he says about it. And you know what? There ain't no security there whatsoever. I mean, every kind of his long answer you can think of, he's stuck in there. Because he doesn't want anybody to know for certain that they're going to go to heaven. Otherwise, they might just start sinning. Or they might not continue to abide. Or they might just, you know, take their relationship with God, you know, for granted. Scary book. Going to chapter 8 of Romans. It's like, he's denied everything that Paul just said in that chapter. Very scary. Beautiful Bible, though. Too bad it's so full of this garbage. And we know that the Son of God is come and hath given us an understanding that we may know Him that is true, and we are in Him that is true, even in His Son Jesus Christ. And I don't see any as long as is in there. No as long as's. Jesus didn't put any as long as's in chapter 10 of John either. This is the true God and eternal life. We have God's life and it goes on forever from the moment we place our faith in Jesus Christ. Now John made it really clear, John 5:24, John 3:36, John 3:16, whoever believes has eternal life. From the moment you place your faith in Jesus Christ, you got eternal life and there's nothing anybody can do about it. Not the devil, not the world, and not you. Why? Because you were given the Holy Spirit. And now He gives you the want to do what is pleasing to God. And now He enables you to do what is pleasing to God. And now He empowers you to do what is humanly impossible, that gives Jesus a glory with your life. Pretty neat. This is the true God and eternal life. This is what it means to be a real Christian. This is who God really is. And then verse 21. Seems like it comes out of nowhere. It almost like knocks you off your feet. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. What? I mean, we've just gone through this whole thing, and I'm just in love with Jesus more than I can ever imagine because He has so secured my relationship with Him. It's just amazing. I could just hold on tight to God because I don't have to be holding on. He's holding on to me. And then it says, little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. What? Why have I been talking about Gnostics since we've been going through this book? Because it is an idol. Yeah, John was the pastor in Ephesus congregation towards the end of his ministry before they exiled him to Patmos. And yeah, they had this big, huge temple to Artemis or Diana. And, Paul got in trouble because too many people accepted the Lord, and all these folks who were in the occultic arts, they burned all their books and all these occultic manuscripts that were worth millions of dollars, and they burned it all up. And people stopped buying all these statues that, all the metallurgists, the teamsters were, they got together and they kicked Paul out. Hey, you're wrecking our economy here, We can't even hardly... put shoes on our kids' feet because nobody's going to buy these statues anymore. Well, yeah, there was absolutely idolatry going on there. But this book isn't written to the Ephesians. It's a general epistle written to everybody. But it's a really pagan world out there. But in the context, he's talking about everything that is not Jesus Christ, God the Son, is an idol. I mean, we got somebody running for the President of the United States who says, as God once was, so are we. And what God... Yeah, how does it go? And what...
As God once was, so are we.
As God is now, so we are. Yeah, whatever. I'm sorry, I got it wrong. Anyway, why? That's what all Mormons think. That's what all they say. We're going to become gods. Well, it's no different than the New Age teachings, where they're doing what the Hindus have done for thousands of years, where they proclaim themselves to be Brahma, the creator. So the creation becomes creator, and they do that as they practice yoga. Well. As you're there, twisting your body and tweaking all your nerve endings, you go into this place of nothingness, and then something starts talking at you. And then it opens up your chakras, and you get this kundalini power. Why in the world would anybody have that in their church? Yoga is Hinduism. Somebody who says, oh, well, it's just exercise, and we can do it to the glory of God. You're deceived. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. Keep yourselves from idols. You got this Pentecostal church on the west side a year ago who was having kundalini dances. What are you thinking? I know Christians who just love all the Native American stuff. And they got, they got their Kachina dolls here, and they got their Kukapellis over here, and they got all this other stuff all over the place because they think it's cool. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. I didn't talk much about the emergent church, but there's a bunch of folks who basically got tired of what the Bible teaches, and they want to reinterpret, they want to refashion Jesus into something that works for our postmodern culture. Because we don't have a Jesus that this world wants. Because nobody wants to know that they're a sinner and need somebody to die on the cross for their sins. They call that a slaughterhouse religion. And they call themselves Christians, but they reject what Jesus did on the cross for them. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. God has told us who He is. Jesus has told us who He is. The Holy Spirit has told us who He is. We don't need a substitute. This world's got all kinds of substitutes for God the Father. There are churches who are worshiping Gaia. That ain't God the Father. There's people who call themselves Christians and they're worshiping the Queen of Heaven. That isn't the Mother of God. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Everywhere we look outside right now, this time of the year, it's just getting worse and worse and worse, and it's going to be worse for the next 2 weeks. People are hanging orange light bulbs on their houses. And they've got all these, you know, RIP little, you know, gravestones, and they got the black cats, and then they got the blow-up ghouls, and you know, and they got the scary lights, and they got all this weirdness. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. If somebody came into your front door and started using profanity and started threatening you and started throwing things around in your house, you'd call the police and have them taken out. So why in the world would you turn on the TV and have that stuff come into your front living room? If your own family member started engaging in, you know, extramarital sex, you would be horrified. Why have your TV on and watch it? Why bring it into your house? Well, I don't have any idols. And you're letting the kids watch in cartoons that have all these pagan imageries coming to them. And they start getting coloring books that have all these ugly pagan things in them, and they're coloring them. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. I think I told you the story about what happened to my mom. We weren't warned about things as a Lutheran. There was no weird spiritual realm to worry about. It was never any kind of consideration. And my mom was selling Artex, which was this, you know, liquid embroidery, and you basically are using a ballpoint pen and coloring pictures on fabric, and then it doesn't wash off. And the little group that she was in this multi-level marketing company called Artex, the group that she was in was called the Kachina Dolls. The other group that she was in was called the Ladybugs. That was fine. You had ladybugs and everything and little pins. That's fine, whatever, ladybugs. Who cares about ladybugs? They're little predatory insects. They eat the bad guys. I like ladybugs. But this other group she was in was called the Kachina Dolls. So she made this dress. And she spent months putting this big Kachina doll on her dress. She was meditating on that Kachina doll as she was painting it, as she was putting out the pattern. She was not thinking about the things of the Lord. She was thinking about that idol. And she was thinking that it wasn't anything wrong. It was just some Native American thing. I remember it, when I was a kid at that time, we'd go camping, and I could tell because of what I had read and studied. You could see what top of what little hill or low foothill or whatever, something that people used to live on, because of the way it's kind of rounded and sort of flat, and then the way the rubble looks kind of like a crown. You could tell, you can go up there and you could find stuff from the Native Americans. And I could pick them out. We could be driving at 65 miles an hour and I'd say, there's one right there. And so I remember stopping, it was near Beaver Creek, and hey, that's one, just like, I'm sure that's one. We went up there and sure enough, in the cave of one side, definitely somebody was living there, and you could see all the patterns of where the building had been on top of the mountain. And on the one side of the mountain, we kept finding all these beautiful pieces of broken pottery with all the nice shapes and everything. And I was even praying to God that we would find a Kachina doll for my mom. My mom was going into deeper and deeper and deeper depression because she was thinking about this idol, not taking it seriously. It was the worst time of my life as a child because she was no longer lucid. She became the baby of the family. And it was the consequences of the idol. Now, we were never told to, about fetishes or anything like that, but in those days, everybody had owls on everything. I mean, we still got towels, I think, in my folks' house. They got little owls on them. These are Native American fetishes. You don't mess around with stuff like that. There was some friends of mine who had done missionary work, and they were touring, and they were taking pictures in these idol temples. And they were dealing with depression. The college I had gone to, the dean of men had written a book. He got this, not a book, but it was a synodical paper dealing with the occult, and so he did all this study in the occult. And he went into severe depression. There are horrible consequences to focusing on this kind of stuff. And now we've got a complete ugly culture that is focusing on the demonic realm, glorifying the dead. And you got these pirate movies, and now everybody wants to be a pirate. Well, what is that? You're hurting people, you're taking advantage of them, you're killing them and stealing their stuff. And you got skulls on everything. I mean, we're trying to get clothes for a niece, and trying to get clothes for a grandchild, trying to find something for a little boy that doesn't have skulls on it. I mean, it's ridiculous. The glorification of the dead, and it's a big, huge deal. I mean, I understand, from the Celtic background and the Druid background of all the folks that come from, Ireland and Scotland and so on, and they come to America in, 19th century, and they brought all this stuff, and that's where we get this Halloween stuff from. And then you've added the Mexican culture of the Day of the Dead, and you add it all together, and you add it to the abundance of America, and you turn it into something that is close neck and neck with the amount of money that the retailers can make with Christmas. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. What are we thinking about? What are we dwelling on? What are we meditating on? Are we meditating on the God who saw us in our horrible, sinful condition, that we were dead in our transgressions and sins, and He came and He became a man so that He would be obedient in our place and then die a horrible, painful, excruciating death on the cross to pay for our sins, so that whoever looks upon Him, whoever places their faith in Jesus Christ, will receive life and not have to receive the death that is due us for rebellion against a holy God. And Jesus rose from the dead, so we rise. We've got something to look forward to for an eternity. There's so many idols. The Catholic Church and then also the Lutheran Church, when you have them do the Ten Commandments, the second commandment is missing. The first commandment is have no other gods before me. Second commandment is they jump right past it. Why? Because the Catholic Church in a lot of Luther churches, they got idols all over the place from all these dead saints. And you're supposed to meditate on their godly life. But they're praying to them. Now keep yourselves from idols. They removed the commandment that talks about don't create a graven image. Well, we've got movies and TV, and there's images all over the place that are substituting for a real relationship with God. And we're getting deceived. And our concept of a holy life is dumbed down by the TV. I grew up really a good Christian household. I wasn't allowed to say any of the bad words. And there was a song on the radio that used God's name in vain. And I was horrified. And it kept bothering me. And this song kept coming on. And it hurt me to hear it. And then they started using God's name in vain on TV. And then they were using God's name in TV in comedies. And people are laughing. And they're sinning and they're doing funny things in the sin. And the sin is now used as a joke. And people who are pursuing sinful lifestyles are made to be comedians. And my concept of sin is getting mushy. It's getting diluted. Things that I knew were right and wrong, now I could say a dirty joke because I'd rather have somebody laugh than me giving glory to God with my mouth. Because being funny is more important than giving God pleasure. And our concept of sin is mixed up. And we start thinking that what the TV says is okay is okay. It's okay for me to use those kinds of words. It's okay for me to joke around like that. It's okay for me to philosophically throw ideas around that aren't necessarily biblically true. Now he says, little children, keep yourselves from idols. It's a big deal. It's a huge big deal. Because the more we have an idol in our life, the more we're looking at it. And the more our lives are being changed by it. Having an idol is denying all the truth and all the confidence that we've just spent the last five chapters of 1 John looking at. An idol is no different than anything that's antichrist. It's taking the place of Jesus Christ in our life. It is giving us information instead of us listening to God. It is telling us how to think instead of being led by the Holy Spirit. Now, we are saying the words that are coming out of the mouths of the folks on TV. We should be saying the words that come out of Jesus' mouth. Now we're thinking of the thoughts that the world system is telling us to think. This is how you're supposed to look at this. This is how you're supposed to feel about this. We need to have God's words. We need to have God's thoughts. All of that is what is the pressure put upon us to believe the truth and have the confidence that John wants us to have, that the Holy Spirit wants us to have. We can know that we have eternal life. We can know that we are holding on tight to the one who's holding on even tighter to us. Who is already victorious over the grave. Who is already victorious over our sin. And he's going to give us anything and everything that's within his will. You're not going to hear that from the idol on TV. Idol on TV says you're not going to be happy until... You're not going to be fulfilled until. You're not going to be a real human being until. And then we live our life in discontent lying about the one who has given us everything. So we need to stay away from idols. Absolutely keep yourselves from idols. We can keep ourselves from idols. Otherwise we wouldn't be commanded to do so. I want to challenge everybody to not have any media on for a day. Just a day. And then I want to challenge you to take that into 3 days. And then another challenge to take it into a week. Now it's kind of difficult because people have to communicate with texts and have to communicate with, you know, phones and things. It's kind of difficult. You can't just say, well, I'm not going to talk to anybody at work and I'm going to lose my job. But you know what I'm saying? We have got so many things that have disconnected us from real fellowship, from one Christian to another, by having something that's synthetic. And we have had all kinds of things that fill our life, that keep us from a real fellowship with Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who loves us enough to stay on the cross until every last thing that He hated about us, He would take the punishment for. And we don't have real relationships with people. And the devil has stolen an entire generation with Twitters and with Facebook and with MySpace. And people aren't having real fellowship, a real relationship with another human being. They're having it synthetically through a little machine. And he's winning. It's not real. It's an idol. It's an idol. It is not real. Why do we need shrinks and psychologists and psychoanalysts? Because people aren't talking to each other. Because there isn't anyone who has the gift of exhortation or the gift of prophecy to be able to heal someone else's soul. Because nobody is talking to you. Something that isn't real is talking to you. Why are there antidepressant drugs? Because people are trying to figure out how to be happy and still continue in sin. They have broken off their relationship with the God of the universe who loves them, who stayed on the cross to pay for every one of their sins. It says, little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. Lord Jesus, we thank you for what you did for us. Lord, help us just respond to you with nothing getting in the way. We want to worship you. We want to love you with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength. Lord, let us make the best use of our mind and our strength and our heart to love you back with everything that we've got. And our love will never come close to the love that you've proven to us over and over again, and the once and for all love that you showed us. We thank you, Jesus, for this kind of love. Lord, help us live in confidence towards you, not listening to any demonic lie that makes us doubt, but have full assurance of our relationship with you, staying in unhindered fellowship with you, walking in the light as you were in the light, knowing that it's your blood that cleanses us, continues to cleanse us from all of our sin. Thank you, dear Jesus, for what you've done for us. Thank you that you indeed are God the Son. You died and you rose. And all authority in heaven and earth has been given to you. And we're waiting for you to return, to take us to be with you forever. Lord Jesus, come back quickly. In Jesus' name, amen.